Welcome to the Westport Library. Today's program will begin momentarily. Supported by Verso Studios, created locally and shared with the world.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us tonight at the Westport Library. My name is Alex Giannini. I'm the Associate Program Director here. This evening's program is the perfect kickoff to our just-announced Westport Reads season, where Art Heists will take center stage. Tonight, we'll meet the major players in the effort to solve the art world's greatest mystery, and in January, we'll dive deep into the world of the art thief, Michael Finkel's captivating book about master thief Stefan Breitweiser. Mr. Finkel will join us in person at the library on Friday, January 26th, so please do mark your calendars and register now for that event at westportlibrary.org. In addition, copies of the book, The Art Thief, are available right now for you to check out. But before we get to the world's greatest art thief, let's talk about the world's greatest art theft. Earlier this year, I received a somewhat mysterious email asking what I knew about the Gardner Museum heist. If I wanted to know more, I should call the number provided. Obviously, I was intrigued. And so a clandestine meeting was set with one Allen Swerdlowe, world traveler, architect, academic, and Fulbright specialist. I'll let you figure out how much that story is BS, but I did want to know more, and I called the number. What is absolutely true from that story is that over the course of the past few months of putting this program together with him, I've greatly enjoyed my talks with Alan about his insights into the Gardner mystery. Like many of you, I first became aware of the world's largest art heist thanks to the excellent Netflix series, This is a Robbery. And like many of you, I followed the case down a bit of a rabbit hole. That rabbit hole led me to Stephen Kurkjian's definitive book on the robbery, Master Thieves, and then to the Last Scene podcast, where we meet, among others, FBI agent and art recovery specialist, Robert Wittman. For his part, Mr. Kurkjian is one of the most acclaimed investigative reporters in the country. A 40-year veteran of the Boston Globe, he is the paper's former Washington bureau chief and a founding member of its investigative spotlight team. Kurkjian has won more than 25 national and regional awards, including the Pulitzer Prize on three occasions. Steve covered much of the investigation into the Gardner heist while in the Globe newsroom. Robert K. Wittman joined the FBI as a special agent in 1988 and was assigned to the Philadelphia Field Division. As a result of specialized training in art, antiques, jewelry, and gem identification, he served as the FBI's investigative expert in art and cultural property crime investigations. In 2010, Bob penned and published the New York Times best-selling memoir, Priceless, How I Went Undercover to Rescue the World's Stolen Treasures, written with 2009 Pulitzer Prize finalist John Schiffman. Priceless follows Wittman through his career with the FBI, providing a first perspective account of some of the most well-known art heists in modern history and the undercover FBI stings that sought to foil them. Now, I can't promise that you'll leave here tonight knowing who done it that fateful night at the Gardner, but I can promise you that whatever rabbit hole you and I have dived down regarding this heist, the three men you're about to meet on stage have been much further down that and other rabbit holes pertaining to the theft. So let's crack open this mystery first with Allen Swerdlowe. After graduating from Columbia University's Masters of Architecture program, Allen founded D7 Architects with expertise in designing residences, commercial spaces, and urban places. He has played significant roles in the reconstruction of the World Trade Center and the development of Brooklyn Bridge Park. So would you all please join me in welcoming the man who put this evening together, Mr. Allen Swerdlowe.
I was just told to break a leg. I hope that doesn't happen. I was actually at another presentation a few months ago, and our main presenter the night before broke her leg. So at least I'm here today. So let's go to the first slide. Okay, so this is the greatest heist of art masterpieces in history. I'd also like, before we start, to thank the Westport Library, Alice Giannini, the program director, the Isabella Gardner Museum security director who spent much of a day with me at the museum, the four-part Netflix series, This Is a Robbery, You Must See It, the 10-part WBUR podcast, Last Seen, You Must Listen to That, local writer David Meth for his support, Bob Wittman from the FBI who's here, and Stephen Kurkjian, who you've just heard his resume, 3 Pulitzer Prizes, founder of the Spotlight team, and also played in the movie by an actor. He's here as well. So before we start, let's have a show of hands. Who thinks they know this story? Just raise your hand. Okay, almost everybody. Who has a theory? Raise your hand. Oh, just a handful of people. And lastly, who knows where the work is or has the work? Raise your hand. Okay, we have a few people. We'll end the presentation here and interrogate those people. The FBI person will do that for me. Okay, so let's begin.
Have you seen these paintings? They're worth $500 million and they disappeared 30 years ago. Whoever finds them will receive a $10 million reward. But let's go back to the beginning.
Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum was a artist's delight. Millions of dollars worth of artwork.
Rembrandt, Degas, Vermeer.
St. Patty's Day, 1990.
Two men dressed as police officers show up at the door.
And they say very dramatically, "Gentlemen, this is a robbery."
There's no shortage of possible suspects. Boston was the Wild West.
The two front runners, all the Italian mob, all the Irish mob.
Hey, how you doing?
The mafia knew that having a stolen masterpiece is a get-out-of-jail-free card. The feds will deal with you. They'll let you out of jail.
It's an easy, easy score, as they say on the street.
There were 13 works taken. Most important, a storm on the Sea of Galilee.
It's the only Rembrandt seascape in existence.
This was huge, not just locally, but internationally.
In Dublin, stolen art was used by the IRA as an international currency.
In Boston, Whitey Bulger provided the IRA with weapons. The paintings could be in the Middle East.
Japan.
South America.
What? It's mind-blowing.
I've spent 25 years on this case. There's got to be a way to figure out where these paintings went.
You could potentially get immunity. You could get $10 million. And that's why this case is so confounding. There's a lot of deaths. Everybody who apparently did the robbery is whacked.
Works of art connect to the community.
Standing in front of that painting would be an unbelievable experience.
When I see those frames, I feel that they are waiting for the work to come back.
They're out there. Somebody stashed them. Sometimes it's the next generation. Grandpa's dead. Look what we got.
I can watch this endless numbers of times and not get bored with it, but if you really want to invest an hour of your time, watch this, I should say 4 hours of your time, watch the 4-part series on Netflix. Okay. So let's start with Isabella Stewart Gardner herself. This is one of the many paintings made by John Singer Sargent of her. She lived from 1840 to 1924 and was a leading American art collector, philanthropist, and patron of the arts. She founded the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston. The painting is titled El Jaleo. It was painted in 1882 by Sargent. It's monumental, 7.5 feet by 11.5 feet, based on drawings he made in southern Spain in 1879. It is named for Andalusian dance and is roughly translated into the ruckus. This is a painting you can hear as well as see. Heels clicking, fingers snapping, hands clapping, the sound of singing and guitars. Isabella Gardner's elaborate setting for this painting features an alcove defined by a Moorish arch. Isabella met the charming and intelligent Harvard student Bernard Berenson in 1886. With friends from Gardner and others, Berenson set off for Florence in 1887 to pursue a literary career. but soon discovered his true calling as a connoisseur of Italian Renaissance art. He became Isabella's chief art advisor, helping her acquire many of the masterpieces in her collection. Bernstein wrote of Isabella, "She lives at a rate and intensity with a reality that makes other lives seem pale, thin, and shadowy." Her first major purchase, the concert by Vermeer, detail is shown here, was a personal choice by the music-loving Gardner. At the auction in December 1892, she observed the social proprieties of the time by using a male agent to bid on her behalf, signaling him with a wave of her handkerchief, and beating off competition from the National Gallery in the Louvre. Her winning bid was $6,000. The male bidders representing the Louvre were especially unhappy when they discovered that it was an American woman who outbid them. In just one swoop, she became a major player in the international art world. Isabella was especially passionate about Venice, where she would often stay at the Palazzo Barbero, pictured here on the Grand Canal. In the summer of 1897, she traveled through Venice, Florence, and Rome to gather architectural fragments for her eventual gallery. She purchased columns, windows, and doorways to adorn every floor, as well as reliefs, balustrades, capitals, and statuary from the Roman, Byzantine, Gothic, and Renaissance periods. Construction of Isabella's museum began in 1899 and was completed in late 1901. She moved into a private fourth floor living quarter and devoted herself to personally arranging works of art from the historic galleries on the first three floors. In 1901 and 1902, Isabella installed her collection of paintings, sculptures, tapestries, furniture, manuscripts, rare books, and decorative arts. She continued to acquire works and changed the installations for the rest of her life. Gardner collected and carefully displayed a collection comprised of more than 7,500 paintings, sculptures, furniture, textiles, silver, ceramics, 3,000 rare books, and 7,000 archival objects from ancient Rome, medieval Europe, Renaissance Italy, Asia, the Islamic world, and 19th century France and America. Another painting by Sargent. Gardner died in 1924, leaving a museum, in quotes, for the education and enjoyment of the public forever. She provided an endowment to operate the museum, stipulating in her will that nothing in the gallery should be changed and no items be acquired or sold from that collection. And to this day, that remains true. The Gardner Museum is more remarkable than it looks at first. It's a palace that has been turned inside out, with its real facades on the inside four sides of the atrium, washed by sunlight and modulated in such a way that it often resembles light reflected off water, as it would be in Venice. As much as any single work of art within the museum, most visitors take away the experience of the courtyard, where the stonework arches, columns, and walls create an unforgettable impression. By integrating Roman, Byzantine, Romanesque, Gothic, and Renaissance elements and stone columns, she could have created a discordant mess. Instead, it is a beautiful and harmonious whole. The Gardner desperately needed to expand. One of the challenges of creating a new wing was both to respect and complement Isabella's vision. The new building needed to be close enough to the historic building to produce attention, but not overshadow it. Renzo Piano, its architect, said that the new building must be a respectful nephew to the great aunt. Piano obsessed over the correct distance between the historic palace and the new wing, likening it to two people needing to be just the right distance from each other to have a conversation. In January 2012, the Gardner Museum welcomed audience to commemorate the opening of the museum's new wing. The program for the new wing includes the addition of a new entryway, special exhibition galleries, concert hall, apartments for visiting artists, on-site greenhouses, and a range of support spaces for conservation, maintenance, and administration. So the original museum was completed in 1901, three floors of about 70,000 square feet, containing about 15,000 objects, 13 pieces stolen On March 18th, 1990, beginning at 1:20 a.m., for 81 minutes, valued at about $1 billion, but really priceless. But they left untouched, as they did many other masterpieces, The Rape of Europa, painted by Venetian artist Titian, circa 1560, 1562, possibly the Gardner's most valuable masterpiece in its original gallery. So that provides a context for this, gives you some information about Isabella, about her museum, about her wishes, her will, and what has happened since. But now I think let's turn it over to the heist. And my colleague, Stephen Kurkjian, investigative journalist, will join me.
Well, thank you, Alan. And thank you, Westport Library, and your tech people for inviting us and paying attention to this, because I'm a Boston boy. I grew up in one of the neighborhoods of Boston, and the city has changed so immensely since then, and even since this March 18th, 1990 theft. We've become a world-class city. We recovered from the devastation of the Marathon bombing in 2013, and I think but glory awaits us in recovering this artwork. My book came out in 2015, Master Thieves, and I've spoken dozens, hundreds of times. Libraries smaller than this, gathering smaller than this, but the key to the recovery is not what I do, retired FBI agent Bob Wittman does, has done in investigating. The key is to play upon the theme of why she opened this museum, why she traveled the world over, and not just to Paris and London, but to the civilizations, Far East, Middle East, all over the world, with her husband, Jack Gardner, whose money she spent. And that was to build a museum where the newcomers in America, the immigrants, could appreciate the art of the ages. She knew America had become a world-class power in the late 19th century. It was leading the Industrial Revolution. But having visited those civilizations of the past, she realized that love and appreciation of art, everything passes, art endures. She understood that. So when she opened the museum in 1903, she had two directives. One is it be free of charge. Why? Because she wanted all of us, immigrant Boston, to come and look. Because she knew the next Rembrandt, the next Van Gogh, it doesn't matter what class you're in. It's that drop of mercuricum that that person, that artist gets. And that person can come from whatever classes. And that's a theme to me that should drive an attempt to those people who know where the art, these 13 pieces. In the 34 years since this theft took place, not a single piece has been seen except for one individual, a jeweler from Boston, who said soon after the theft, a bad guy whom he knew, who he didn't presume until the bad guy showed up with one of the pieces and showed him. And he said, get that away from me. Don't you know 40 FBI agents are on the streets looking for you? But it's the endless effort to find it through investigation. And I say that's not the way to do it. Urge Boston. We don't become a world-class city until this artwork returns. She wanted them on the walls for us. My father, a survivor, a teenager, came to America as a teenage survivor of the Armenian Genocide. They noticed in high school that he could draw a straight line. The next thing you know, he's going to art school, and he raised his family on the salary of a commercial artist. And he said every day after art school, he would go over to the museum because it was free of charge. You could kind of get up close and see the artwork in the making. And so I have a feeling for this place and the need to get it back. The story about the theft begins on March 18th, 1990, around 1 o'clock, 1:30 in the morning. It's misty. Had been rainy the day before. March 17th was our holy holiday of St. Patrick's Day. And I think they chose the hours after it for this reason. They knew, anybody who's spent a holiday, a St. Patrick's Day in Boston, knows that every police officer, every security guard who is on the payroll is working that full day. So the next shift, which would have begun at midnight, those officers would be working overtime and they'd be a little less active, sharp. So, and what happened at the museum at 1 o'clock in the morning, two men dressed in police uniforms walk up to the side door of the museum. And this is what they looked like. The mustaches were false. They were dressed in Boston police uniforms. And they rang the side doorbell, the entrance, the employee's entrance. And there were two night watchmen on duty that night. One had worked the shift only once or twice before. He had been called in because the regular night watchman, this old timer, was off that night. And but this was the security desk, it's sort of right out in the open of the museum, which was a detriment to good security, but was going to be attended to. The museum had been taken over by a new director, Ann Hawley, only 4 or 5 months before, and she had activism to him. She was going to make this place the crown, the jewel in the crown that it was intended for, that Mrs. Gardner intended for the place. And she got a new security system, but she hadn't attended to improving the grade, the quality of the night watchman. This is the night watchman who was sort of in control that night. He was at the desk when the employee's entrance bell rang, and he said he saw the two police officers. He had a closed circuit TV on him, and he could see from the screen that it was two police officers out front, and they said, "We're here to investigate a disturbance." But in his mind, sort of the last reporter to have interviewed him at length, he said that in his mind that he thought some kids had jumped over the back fence of the museum and were, you know, just causing hooliganism. And somebody might have called the police. In his handbook, in the security guard's handbook, it says, if anybody knocks and says they're the police and wants to come in, you're to call the police and order the police to come in. You don't let anybody in after you lock up for the night. And that had happened an hour before. So, but he thinks that they had, there was some hooligans in the back, so he rang the bell and the buzzer, and he let them in. These two, and he said to them, they came up to him and they said, "Who else is here?" And he said, "The other guard is doing his rounds. Rick had just finished his rounds," and he said, "Call him down." Now, Rick letting them in was one very, very grievous error. And then he made a second grievous error. They said to him, as he was at his desk, "You look familiar. He's back here." And they say to him, "You look familiar. Do we have a warrant out for you? Are we looking for you? Did you not shown up for a court date?" And Rick said, No, I'm a rock and roller. Rick had his rock and roll band. He had no intention of being working security in the future as a future career. He wanted to manage and participate in a rock band, and they were doing pretty well. They were playing around town, and he loved the job. He told me that he would work until around midnight, jump off the bandstand, jump in a cab, and go to work. The shift was midnight to 7:30, excuse me. And he said, often I was stoned, I'll agree. I was drunk, I'll agree. But it didn't matter because nothing ever happened. Nothing until March 18th, 1990. And he's sitting behind that desk, and right around here, there is the only alarm to the outside world. The museum had not put in a very sophisticated alarm system. In fact, they had no replacement insurance, so they didn't have any insurance adjusters walking through the museum telling them, you need to improve this, you need to upgrade that. So, because there was more deficiencies than you would see in any museum or any place of value now. So they said to him, you look familiar, come around, step away from that area, and let's get a good look at you. Rick knew he was stepping away from the only alarm that the museum had. Sorry, let me get that back. And by doing so, he was going to leave the museum without security. If he touched that bell, the bad guys, the alarms would have gone off. They had a private security firm. The alarm at Division 2 in Roxbury, which is closest to the museum, would have sent out cars. But what Rick did, he didn't do that. And I said to him, I said, Rick, why did you, you knew what we were doing. You were leaving the museum unprotected by stepping away from that alarm. This is a Sunday night, as it happens. Why would you do it? And he pointed to his shirt pocket. He said, I had two tickets to the Grateful Dead that night in Hartford, Connecticut, and I didn't want to miss it. And I knew they were cops, and I knew if I had stepped away, if I didn't do what they said and step away from behind the desk and come out to see them in front of the desk, they were going to arrest me, and I would not have gone to my Grateful Dead concert. So I said, I just better go along with them because I think I'm just going to show them that they're mistaken. So that's what he did. Stepped away, came out in front of the security desk, and just as the second guard was coming into the room, they threw them both up against the wall, handcuffed them, and said that lasting words they said to them, this is a robbery. Brought them downstairs, and that's where their activities. Let me see if you can help me with this. Can you help me with this? Okay, I think I got it now. So this is Rick here, and now it's around 1:20 in the morning. I can do that. Okay. Now it's around 1:20 in the morning, and while they use great guile to get in and trickery to get in to get Rick to do what they wanted, then when they went up and began the actual robbery, they became brutal. And as I looked at these, they went from. Most of the larger pieces, in fact, all of the larger, the most expensive pieces were taken from the Dutch room. I'm sure a lot of you folks have been in the museum. When you go there now and you see the empty frames, I akin it to being the first person walking into a wake. The sense of loss and sadness is overpowering. And that night, they broke every frame, every glass front of every frame, and on the larger Rembrandts, so this one, Storm of the Sea of Galilee, and this one, Lady and Gentleman in Black, they cut the canvases out of their frames. Why? The prevailing theory is that they didn't have a big, large getaway car vehicle. They had a hatchback. Remember those Rambler hatchbacks open in the back? That's what they had, and that's they left the museum after about 81 minutes being in there, and they took every piece, all 13 pieces, out to the car in two forays out from the security desk again. As I looked at the crime scene, though, from the photos, I said, you know, there's the prevailing theory is that who could have done this would have been a Mr. Big, a Dr. No, a person who felt he or she could not live without a Rembrandt or a Vermeer, and commissioned these thugs to have pulled it off. The way they damaged, at the point not grievous, but they damaged the artwork in the stealing of it. So I said, there has to be another reason. And the more I did my reporting, I had most of my reporting in my career at the Globe has been political reporting and the clergy abuse. But the more I delved into the underworld, the bad guys of Boston, the more I heard this theory, this belief, that this artwork, getting a piece of art like this, is a get-out-of-jail-free card. And where that idea came from is this gentleman here, a Boston native named Miles Connor. He too, was a rock and roller, and he had pulled off some thefts. And his largest one that I know of was, he was in jail in 1990, but the largest theft he pulled off was a theft of five or six N.C. Wyeth paintings from an estate up in Maine. And as I talked to him and interviewed him, I said, you know, that's a pretty big haul you got up there. Who was in it with you? This was after he wrote his book, and in the book he says, Bobby Donati did it with me. Bobby Donati is this fella here. And this is a painting, this is a photograph given to me by some members of his gang. His leader of that gang was a very smart, intelligent, worthwhile guy in Boston named Vinnie Ferrara. Vinnie Ferrara went to my high school, Latin school, one of the top high schools in Massachusetts, if not America. From there, he went to BC and taking up finance. But coming from the North End, he fell in with the wrong crowd. Very, very forceful guy. And he started a gang. And in the early 80s, the criminal gang that ruled Boston was run by the Angiulos, the Angiulo crime family. Well, they got taken down by a federal indictment. And therefore, the leader of the crime world in Boston, of the mafia organization in Boston, was up for grabs. And Vinnie Ferrara went for it. And he went up against another gang, and their bodies were dropping all over the streets of Boston. It was a gang war. And Bobby Donati, in about 4 months before the Gardner Museum theft went down, the leader of Donati's gang, Vinnie Ferrara, was locked up. I always felt there was something going on. There had to be something about that lockup that made sense, particularly if Donati knew Miles Connor, who knew about art theft. Miles told me, yes, that theft up in Maine, my partner in it had been Bobby Donati. A nice guy, a decent good dose guy, not a very sharp guy, but when Miles got locked up for the theft up in Maine, as he got arraigned, one state cop yelled out to him, "You're gonna need a Rembrandt to get you out of this one." And that put an idea in Miles's mind. And Miles got bailed out. He and his gang stole a Rembrandt out of the MFA. This is about 1973. A couple of months later, Miles's attorney calls up the FBI, says Miles says he can help you get that Rembrandt back, but you got to go easy on him. The FBI says to his lawyer, "We don't do deals. You get us back that Rembrandt. You can tell it to the judge." That's what happened. 1975, the Rembrandt, 2 years after it was stolen, gets brought back to the FBI. There's big headlines. Next couple of weeks, Miles gets arraigned and goes on to trial and gets a sentence, an eight-year sentence on the main robbery and an eight-year sentence, added eight-year sentence, on the MFA robbery. But the judge allows him to serve it one eight-year term. Out of that, still, it's 8 years. He doesn't get off. But out of that legal action comes this belief in the bad guy world in Boston. Oh, you can get out of jail free. They'll let you out. They're not going to let you out. They don't do deals. Ask that to Bob Wittman when he gets up here to talk. The feds don't do deals. You know, they'll get the most out of you that they can. But the bad guys don't believe what they read in the paper. They don't make their decisions on the way you and I make the decisions. You know, they don't do it with, well, talk to my cousin or talk to my uncle or talk to my lawyer, and I'll make the right decision. They make it on whispers, winks and nods, suspicion. And so out of that, Miles's experience comes the belief that this thing was done to get somebody out of jail. Well, as I was finishing my book in the summer of 2014, I got a call from a guy who knew Ferrara very well, and he tells me a story. He says, "Well, what does the FBI say? What is the FBI telling you?" And I said, "Well, they're not talking to me. So, but I think that they believe it was done for this reason or that reason." He says, "No, it was done for me." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "When I was in jail in November of 1989, Donati came to me and said, 'We're going to rob the Gardner Museum. It's an easy heist. Miles Connor has walked me through it, and he has shown me what to steal. And we're going to pull off the theft, and I'll get the artwork, and they'll let you out of jail.'" And this guy says, and he's speaking on behalf of Vinnie Ferrara, he says, "I told him, don't involve me. It's a harebrained idea. It doesn't work. The feds aren't going to do any deals. Don't involve me." But he said, Donati was sure it was going to happen. And it did happen. Now, once I got my information about what Ferrara's second had told me, I went to the FBI. They appreciated my information. Whether or not they acted on it, I don't know. Ferrara never went on the record with me, so I don't know what he says. But I think it was good, because last year, 2021, a gentleman came to me and said that he had been a jeweler in Boston, and that soon after the theft, Bobby Donati had come to him with one of the smaller pieces from the theft, and he told him, "We did it, but I don't know what it's worth. What can I get for this finial?" I don't think I have a photo of the finial, but it's a top of a flagpole, and it's shaped as an eagle, golden eagle. And he brought that in to me, this jeweler was telling me. And I said to him, have you told the feds this? He said, "I told the feds this several years ago." So I did a little bit of homework. I had gotten some information when Donati, when he was under suspicion before he was cruelly killed, about 18 months after the theft. What I think happened was that he gained the artwork, and he had no fence. His reason for stealing him was to get the leader of his gang, Vinnie Ferrara, out of the jail. So here he has, in his very modest Revere home, the artwork of the ages, now worth $1 billion. But he had no fences. He had no place to bring them to. Well, he had a couple of guys. He had a fellow up in Maine, Bobby Guarenti. And the feds in 2013 came out with, without using any names, they said, this gang that was responsible for the theft was a mid-Atlantic gang. And as I cleared away some of the mist on the windshield, what they were talking about is this fella here, Bobby Guarenti, a known heavyweight mobster out of Boston, and his good friend was a fellow from Manchester, Connecticut, Bobby Gentile. And the best that I was able to get for in my book is an account that says Donati was very good friends. In fact, when he was brutally murdered in August of 91, he was missing for 3 days. His then teenage son was looking for him. The first person he called was Bobby Guarenti, because Guarenti knew his dad. And Guarenti said no, he hadn't seen him. Soon after, the story came out that Guarenti's wife called the FBI in 2010, many years later. And they said, my husband had the paintings, but in 2004, before he passed away, he gave them over to his good friend in Manchester, Connecticut, Bobby Gentile. So I had already, you know, done some reporting about Gentile. Many, Ed Mahoney of the Hartford Courant had done some terrific reporting on him on this case. You never could feel that you're in the right place with Bobby Gentile. I interviewed him for 5 hours at his home in Manchester. He unfortunately passed away in 2021, and I interviewed him for 5 hours. And he let me in his home, and the only thing he asked for, if I was going to come back the next day, is bring Regina's pizza. You know, that's all he cared. Just bring me a Regina's pizza. So I brought him 2 pies the next day, and I got invited back the third day if I bring Regina's pizza, which I did. So at the end of the third day of interviewing, and he's denying everything. Deny. And, you know, yes, I was interested in looking for the paintings. Yes, my great friend Bobby Guarenti, he was looking for the paintings with me, but we never found anything, never. And I don't know why the feds are looking at me. They're, you know, it's just, they're making up stories about me. And, before I had gotten into the house, the feds had been in there, and they set him up to sell them some Percocets. And he did a term of 18 months, I think, in jail for selling Percocets to an undercover agent. Well, the only reason they wanted that was so they could search his house. And they did. They went through his house at least 3 times with a fine-tooth comb. And on the first time, they concentrated on this shed in his backyard. And he denies, and that story comes out, well, that shed in his backyard had a false floor. And in the false floor, there was a ditch. And whether it's a big ditch or a smaller ditch, it's where the feds believe, some of the feds, I'm not sure all of them, and they only whisper, they don't really ever say anything on the record, so you really can't pin it down. But the feds believe that Bobby had hid artwork under that false floor, but a flood had taken place in the backyard, and whatever was under that false floor was ruined. So I went to him in, 6-8 months before he passed away, and I'm just a, you know, sit down, here's my notebook, here's my tape recorder, here are my questions. And, but we parried back and forth. Well, the first time I was in with him in 2014, he says to me at the end, you know, I give you a lot of information. What do I get out of it? what do I get out of it? He says, I'm thinking about it. What's he saying? What do I get out of it? He knows I'm a reporter. I can't pay for information. So I say, I think of something to say that can at least get him talking maybe honestly with me. So I said, I tell you what, Bobby, there's a hell of a story here. I'll give my publisher back their down payment for writing a book, and then you and I will write a book. But I don't want any more lies. You're not involved in they're making up stuff. I want the true story. And you get half, and I get half, and we get a bestseller. And I'm thinking, this guy's going to laugh. He's going to laugh at me. What am I erecting this hypothesis in front of him? But he doesn't laugh at me. He looks me in the eye and he drops his head. So I'm thinking to myself, have I gotten this reporting thing all wrong? Am I supposed, when I sit down and talk to someone, you know, many of you have been interviewed by people and local reporters. They ask, you know the questions they're going to ask you, and they ask them, and they say, thank you, shake your hands, and go home. Well, maybe I should have been saying, tell me your deepest fear, your wildest dream, the secret that you're most afraid about, because that's what I was asking him. And now he puts his head down, and he's thinking of what he said. So I've always thought about that as a moment in time on this, that he was going to tell me the secret of the ages, what had happened. And he puts his head up, and they set me up, the feds, they lied to me, they set me up. I had to go to jail. It was all set up. So I gave him a big hug. Thanks, Bobby. And I left, and I called, got into my car, and first person I called was Ryan McGuigan, name many people may have known, a hell of a criminal defense attorney and Gentile's defense attorney, and had gotten me the interview, got me the front door interview with Gentile. And I called him, I said, Ryan, he's been lying to the feds, he's been lying to you, all this denial stuff, and he's been lying to me. For 5 hours, he's been lying to me. And Ryan says to me, what are you talking about? What did he say? And I tell him about the story. He wants a piece of the action. What can I give him? And Ryan says, and you think he was going to tell you something that's different than all his denials? And I said, well, why would he say that? And he said, you know, you're not as sharp as a reporter as I thought you were. He was setting you up. And I said, what do you mean setting me up? You're lucky he didn't do it, because I don't know what you would have said. What he would have asked you is, give me $10,000, and then we'll sit down later and we'll talk about it. He was going to scam you. I said, no. Well, that was my exchange with him. Ryan McGuigan, his attorney, came from his home in a bit away in Connecticut, because he's got a story about his dealing with a Gentile on this. And Ryan, can you get up there and tell that story of, this is Ryan McGuigan, criminal defense lawyer in Hartford, Connecticut.
I'm so happy right now. My first girlfriend's mother is here. I'm so excited.
It all happened.
Hi, Mrs. Watterson, how are you? She should have married me.
No, she shouldn't. We'll talk.
it's great to be here. Steve had called me up and he said, why don't you come down to Westport tonight? It's just, you know, I'm in Connecticut. It's a small state. I said, I live in Lakeville. It's a 2-hour drive from here. But here I am anyways. But I think it was $20,000 he was probably going to take you for. I had some experience with Bob, with media people. And that's why I had warned Steve before. And the first one was Ron Howard's people. And they had called through Ed Mahoney, and they had originally offered me $5 million in a movie deal that Gentile could then just take the money. And the theory at the time was is that he was reluctant to take any money from the FBI because he didn't believe, or he wouldn't have believed, that it would actually come true, and they would throw him in jail anyway. So there was a theory at the time with John Durham and I, who I'd been working with very closely on it, to try to figure out what his reticence was, the reason for it. And perhaps that was it. And it turned out that really wasn't true, because when I told him that, you know, that Richie Cunningham wants to give me, Richie Cunningham wants to give me $5 million. You crazy. You out of your friggin' mind. So, and I told him that was true. And unfortunately, he wanted to sit down with Ron Howard's people and meet them. But at the time, he was in Wyatt Correctional Center in Rhode Island, and Ron Howard didn't want to go there. So that never happened. The second group of people that met with him, surprisingly enough, was Drew Barrymore's people. Yeah. So I had Richie Cunningham, and I had the little girl from E.T. I'm like, this is fantastic. I get to meet all these celebrities. And she sent her husband to meet with me, and I took him to Max Downtown. And he offered me $5 million as well. And said that he would just give me the money straight up, and my client could take the money, and then we could then return the paintings, and he would be the great hero. My client would get the $5 million, and then everybody would be happy. And then the guy didn't buy lunch for me. He made me pay for lunch, and then I told him that's the end of that. You're not getting any paintings. That's a true story. And then the last person was. I'm not going to mention his name. There have been several people in this case, and he knows this to be true. There have been several people in this case that have said, if my name comes out in any proceeding, I will be very upset with you. And I think I know what very upset means. So I've never said their names. Yeah. So this one particular gentleman was from New York, actually, and he was sort of around a hedge fund or a hedge fund guy, whatnot, and he offered me $10 million straight up for the information and for the recovery of the paintings. And it never has, it never prompted my client to do anything but to think, and I would say, hey, you know, Richie Cunningham wants to give you $5 million, and he said, that's great. How are we gonna take advantage of this, Mark? So that was always what right. his MO was, and so I would warn him.
And remind us of the story of when he was on his deathbed down at a southern...
Oh, country. Yeah. So first off, with this is the problem with theories, is that there's the theory that the paintings got wet underneath his shed, and therefore they're destroyed and they're gone. That's the theory, right? Problem with that theory. There's always a problem. Everybody's got a theory, and there's always a problem with it. The problem with that theory is my client was facing, really, about 11, 12 years in jail. And John Durham told me to tell him, if the paintings got destroyed in that scenario, all he has to do is tell me that that's what happened, cooperate in trying to find the remainder of any of the paintings, and if he does that, I will let him go home to his wife. I was playing golf at Morfar. It's up in near where I live, in near Lakeville. And there is AIG people in the house. So I was playing there with a fellow from AIG, and I get a phone call, and it was from an FBI agent, and they told me that my client was dying. And down in South Carolina at Butner. So I immediately called Judge Shotney's chambers and asked if I could get on a flight. I, at that point, was appointed as his public defender because he didn't have any more money. And so I got on an American Airlines flight and flew down to South Carolina and then drove over to Butner. And in the morning, I saw him at about like 6:37 in the morning, and he was incoherent, and I had spoken to this young doctor who was about like 36 years old, and he said, "Are you his son?" And I said, "No, I'm not. I'm his lawyer." And he said he was asking for his son incoherently, and I had spoken to his son and told him that his dad was probably dying, and unfortunately, they had had, understandably, they had a very strained relationship. And so I sat with Bob and I held his hand, and I thought to myself, maybe he'll think that it's his son as he passes on. And a couple hours later, I just looked and his eyes were open. He was looking right at me. And are there any children? I'll say the rated PG. What the F are you doing here? And I said, "Are you surprised to see me?" And he said, "Am I dying?" And I said, "Yeah, Bob, you are." And I wasn't kidding. I did believe that. And I told him that you are dying. That's what they told me. And you're not gonna make it out of here. And he started kicking his legs. And he was shuffling his legs back and forth. He was in a tremendous amount of pain. And he said, "I can't die here. I can't die here. I can't die here. I can't die here. I can't die here." And I said, "Bob, if you tell me anything about these paintings, anything, tell me that they burned. Tell me that they got ruined in water. Tell me that you sold them to somebody. Tell them you brought them to Philly, to Skinny Joe Merlino, or whatever. Just tell me anything that's credible. And I promise you, I can call John Durham on the phone, and I can get you medevaced back to Hartford, and you can die in your wife's arms tonight." And the tears started coming down his eyes, and he just said, "But there ain't no paintings. There ain't no paintings. There ain't no paintings." And he started to cry. And miraculously, I left that night thinking I'd never talk to him again, and I came back the next morning, and his fever had broke, and the antibiotics started to work, and he was on his way to a full recovery for at least a few years. But I did represent him for years after that, as he was even pinched again. And I can tell you that he never, not once ever, said that he ever had the paintings. He never, not once ever, said that he stole the paintings. And he never, not once ever, said that he knew where the paintings were. However, he did take a polygraph on all of those questions. The worst you can do on a polygraph is negative 14. And when my polygrapher talked to him, they called me, they pulled me out of the room and came out, and he said, "He broke my machine." The paintings are still out there.
You're not getting more real than that. Which, again, I go back to the story that this is not just about 13 paintings, and this is not just about the crown or the diamond in the center of Boston's crown of art and culture. This is a story about the city itself, and the city has to be challenged to help in. You know, we're not a city that, or a region or a state that exists on the credo of omerta. That silence, snitches get stitches. It's no longer that way in Boston. But there are still people who adhere to that. And those people know something. Like Gentile, so many of the main actors in this case have died. But still, there are people who know something, snippets of something. And they have to, for their children, I call it for their grandchildren, because their grandchildren could be the next Michelangelo and can be inspired by the artwork that is still missing. So I thank you for letting me tell my part of the story. We're going to end on a real top note. Robert Wittman of the FBI Theft Bureau is going to regale you with his stories, including a story about this crime can be solved, and if it can be solved by an undercover agent, it can be solved by Bob Wittman. So, Bob.
Actually, I just have a couple of other comments before Bob comes up. So one of the things I was really interested in, and what else important has vanished? Of course, thousands, if not millions, of artworks and other important objects have vanished over time. I'll just bring up a couple of them. The Amber Room, you might have heard of that. It was chamber-decorated amber panels, disappeared during World War II. 20% of the Nazis' theft is still unrecovered, and we don't know where any of those artworks are. The site of Nefertiti's tomb is one of the longest-running archaeological mysteries that have left experts puzzled for decades. The recent radar survey of Tutankhamun's tomb shows that there may be hidden chambers of his mother's tomb behind his tomb. And my favorite is this gentleman named Leo Burt, who was indicted in connection with the 1970s Sterling Hall bombing in Madison, Wisconsin. The bombing killed physics researcher Robert Fastnet, destroyed or partially destroyed 38 buildings. And he was involved with making the bomb that had this happen. He disappeared off the face of the earth in 1970 and has not been seen. He's been on the FBI's most wanted list since then. And what about some of the objects that have actually been recovered? The most interesting to me is recently William de Kooning's Woman Okra in 1954 was found, was actually ripped off the walls in a similar fashion to that at the Gardner's at the University of Arizona's Museum of Art in Tucson. And 27 years after that, after it was cut from its frame, in 2017, the owners of a used furniture and antique store in Silver City, New Mexico, nowhere in New Mexico, actually, made national news when they discovered that the de Kooning painting in an estate sale and returned it to its rightful owners at the University of Arizona Museum of Art. Of course, we all know the Mona Lisa has been stolen at least once, possibly twice. And its mysterious disappearance was the most colossal theft in modern times, rendering the painting its world fame. Two of the four Munch paintings called The Scream, there were four of them, had been stolen, one in 1994, the same day of the opening of the Olympics in Norway, and one in 2004 from the Munch Museum, which was ripped off the wall in a similar fashion. Both were subsequently recovered. The last one here is Salvador Mundi, which is a painting attributed in whole or part to Leonardo da Vinci, dating 1499. A long thought to be a copy of the lost original painting, it was rediscovered, restored, and included in a major exhibition of Leonardo's work at the National Gallery in London in 2012. It was purchased by an anonymous bidder in 2017 for $450 million, a record price, exhibited in Hong Kong, London, San Francisco, and then went missing a second time. The last painting, and this is important because this transitions over to Robert. Rembrandt's 1630 self-portrait was stolen from the Swedish National Museum in Stockholm in an armed robbery in December 2000. The small self-portrait on copper was recovered in Copenhagen. Four men were arrested in a hotel in the Danish capital. Bob Wittman, who's about to come up, recovered this, as well as more than hundreds of millions of dollars of important masterpieces and documents, including one of the original 14 copies of the Bill of Rights, the theft of numerous paintings at a private estate in Madrid, five Norman Rockwell paintings from a private gallery in Minneapolis, he discovered them in a farmhouse in Brazil. But let's have Bob do the talking for himself. Bob?
Thank you. we have to switch up real quick. I got a PC, he's got Apple. So.
I'm not PC. By the way, we can talk a little more about the $5 and $10 million, Ryan, a little later on.
That's a good question. So it works. Technology works. That was a good intro you gave me there, Alan. And just let's see if it does work. Okay. Yeah, these are a couple of books I've written. In fact, I think the library has copies of Priceless, my memoir, that I wrote in 2010. I was at the FBI from 1988 to 2008 when I retired. And during my 20 years there, I guess I recovered about $300 million worth of stolen art and cultural property. That's what I specialized in, was art theft. In 2005, I started the National Art Crime Team, which basically is in existence today. I think there's 24 agents on the team today. When I started it back in 2005, we had 8 guys that were on the team. It was about that time that we really started to get involved, we being the FBI. We had always worked art thefts as property crimes. You have to understand, in law enforcement parlance and law enforcement situations, a stealing of a Monet is no different than a Chevrolet. Okay, so it's just property, right? I mean, that's what it is. It's not, and unless the gun's used, unless there's violence, it elevates the crime itself, but the actual theft of property is just property. So it wasn't until 2005 that we started that team. And Priceless has been published around the world. My second book, this Devil's Diary, was a book about a recovery of a diary by Alfred Rosenberg for the U.S. Holocaust Museum. And we recovered that in 2013. So there's been some pretty good intros I've had over the years. Alan gave me a good one. I like this one better.
National art crime scene. I hear a lot of the suspects have been framed. Please welcome Robert K. Wittman. Hey, Mr. Wittman, thank you so much for coming on.
So we know, you know, the Gardner theft is a very, very serious topic, but we have to have a little bit of levity, right? So I thought we'd bring in Mr. Colbert a little bit, and we'll talk about art crime. Now, I did work on the Gardner case, okay? And I'm going to talk to you about that, tell you about it. But I like to talk to you overall about art crime in general, because that's really what my field is. And you have to understand, why do people steal art? Why do people steal these things to begin with? Because, you know, they're very difficult to sell. If you look at the entire business, the art business is a $200 billion business worldwide every year. $200 billion gets bought and sold. The largest consumer country in the world is the United States. We do about $80 billion a year. 40% of the overall art market is right here in the U.S. So it's a big business. It's a lot of money. Back in the early 2000s, I got a call from our headquarters in Washington, and they had gotten a call from the New York Times. And at times it asks, what's the size of the illicit cultural property market? What is the numbers worldwide for stolen art, fraudulent art, fake, forgeries, the whole crime market? So we did a research with the Carabinieri in Italy, with the OCBC in Paris, which is their art theft group. I spoke with the Scotland Yard, the Art and Antique Squad. And we came up with a figure of about $6 billion a year. That's the illicit cultural property market. And quite honestly, I'd say 75% of that, probably $4 billion, maybe more, is frauds, forgeries, and fakes. it's not stolen art. Okay, people don't steal that much art. It's more about frauds, forged. So you're more likely to be the victim of a fraud than you are an actual theft. Quite honestly, if you're gonna buy a Picasso on eBay, just be sure. Be sure there's two S's in Picasso. Okay? Yeah. And hey, there's no A in Monet, okay? Just remember that when you're buying these things. And when you make that mistake, don't call us. call Ryan, the attorney. He'll take care of you. So that's the thing. And you know, what's happened is the price of art, the price of collectibles, the price of all these things have gone up. And you have to understand, everybody's a collector. Every one of you here tonight collects something, okay? I mean, you might not think of yourself as an art collector, but ladies, if you have more than, say, two pairs of Jimmy Choo shoes, you're a collector. And gentlemen, if you have more than a couple of cars, or you have a set of watches, you're a collector. So everybody collects something. You know, when I'm in Naples doing these talks, like Naples, Florida, they collect husbands and wives. It's a whole different thing. But everybody has something that they collect. So many years ago, there was a bank robber. His name was Willie Sutton, and he was captured by the FBI. And as he was being led off to jail, a reporter asked him, and Steve might remember this, Willie, why do you rob banks? And Willie turned around and said, because that's where the money is. Yeah. Well, in today's world, that's where the money is, the art market. Look at this this card at the end here. It's a Tom Brady card. It sold for $2.25 million. That's his rookie card. This Action Comics, the first one, this was the first Superman comic, sold for $3.5 million. I mean, at least that's old. It's from the 30s. This Mario Brothers game, some of you might have one in your attic. You know, go home and take a look, right? My kids played that back in the late 80s, early 90s. That recently sold for $660,000. And the shocker here is this one. This is a Mickey Mantle rookie card. Granted, it's from the 50s. It's in good shape, but it's not signed. It's signed in the plate. $12 million. You know what that means? That means if you're home and you have a Mickey Mantle rookie card, and it doesn't have to be in great shape, even if it's in lousy shape, it'll sell for $125,000. Think about that. I saw one advertised just recently at an auction. It's graded level 3 because it's such a bad shape card. It was estimated at $125,000. So that makes it worthwhile, doesn't it? You know, the average bank robbery in the United States nets $1,000 or less. And that's a federal crime. You steal a Mickey Mantle from Westport, you try to sell it in Bridgeport, it's not a federal crime. It's a local crime, but it's a property crime. But you can get $125,000 for it, and you can't trace it because there's no serial numbers on that card, on any of those cards. So that's why criminals go after artwork. That's what it's all about. There are theories about, you know, people stealing art because they want to get out of jail. That's, you know, I've done this for 35 years, you know, professionally. And from what I've seen about art theft and collectible theft, it's about money. It's all about money. The getting out of jail free part, that occurs in some countries that have different legal systems. But in the United States, it's very difficult because, like I told you, it's a property crime. So you're not going to get a downward departure on a sentencing if you did a bank robbery where you shot the guard because you stole a painting. That's not going to happen. The judge is not going to give you a downward departure on that. The U.S. attorney's not going to authorize or ask for it. And in today's world, the U.S. attorney doesn't have the power to give you a downward departure. All they can do is ask the judge. They tell the judge what the criminal did, and if the judge thinks it's worth it, then they might give a downward departure in the sentencing. But it's up to a judge, not the lawyers. So ultimately, stealing an artwork is not going to get you out of jail. Not in this country now. If you do it in Norway, yeah, maybe. If you do it in France, maybe. Depends. I've seen it. But not in the United States. Usually a downward departure doesn't come from artwork or property crime. It comes from giving up bigger fish, okay? So you're small on a drug line, and you're selling drugs on the street, and you can give up the Colombian cartel guy, you might get a downward departure. That's kind of how it works. You got to go up the ladder. So these are the collectibles today that are out there that people are buying that, you know, that are worth a lot of money. So what are the statutes? These are the laws that protect you as a consumer in the United States. Interstate transportation of stolen property. The really interesting one up there is called the theft of major artwork. And if you look at those, you're going to see there's only one statute, okay, that protects, you know, art collectors that has the word art in it. And that's the theft of major artwork statute. That was passed in 1996. It was put forth by Ted Kennedy. Of course, he's from Massachusetts. And what it does, it makes it a federal crime to steal from a museum. So think about that. It's you know, up until that point, it wasn't a federal crime to steal from a museum. It's like just a local theft. But now, if you go to a museum and you steal something, and that something is considered an object of cultural heritage, and if it's worth $5,000 or more and is over 100 years old, it's a federal crime. If it's worth $100,000 or more, it's a federal crime. And it's punishable by up to 20 years in prison, depending on the value. The reason that was passed and was put forth by Ted Kennedy, because Congress wanted to make the Isabella Stewart Gardner theft a federal crime. And that's what did it. That gave jurisdiction to the FBI to do the primary investigation. But interestingly enough, there's a second part to that. There's a part B to that statute. And what that says is anyone who possesses, who exhibits, transports, tries to sell an object of cultural heritage stolen from a museum. Once they know it's stolen, they don't have to know it came from a museum. If they find out that it's stolen, if they continue to do that, it's a re-upping of the federal crime. So what that does is it changes the whole basic background of artwork, the due diligence questions. So to give you an example, I had a case involving an individual who had a Renoir, a small Renoir, $50,000 Renoir, and it was stolen from the Baltimore Museum of Art 50 years before this person got it. Well, once he found out that this was stolen, he had to return it because his continued possession of it was a federal crime. So you see how that works. It has to be turned over. That's because Congress wanted to make it a statute, put forth a statute that would allow the recovery of the Gardner paintings. Hasn't worked yet, but that statute's been used many times. It's a great statute. But there are limitations to law enforcement that we haven't talked about. Basically, the fact is it's gotta be a crime. You know, any kind of situation where law enforcement gets involved, you have to have a criminal situation. It's gotta be a violation of a statute. So when I retired from the FBI in 2008, I started my own company, and we do all these types of investigations, many of which we do turn over to the feds, we do turn over to local law enforcement, but oftentimes it is, you know, basically civil material. And these are civil cases. So let's get into the Gardner. Well, very quickly, just to give you a background on why I did it the way I did it when I did the investigation that I had involving the Gardner. I had been working around the world. I probably worked in 20 different countries, all right, recovering stolen paintings. And this was a Rembrandt that was stolen. It was worth $35 million. Stolen at gunpoint from the Swedish National Museum in Stockholm, as Al told you. We did an undercover operation in Copenhagen where we were able to recover that and arrest the individuals that were involved. This was stolen in Sweden, ended up in Copenhagen 5 years after the theft. This is a Goya painting that was stolen in Madrid, Spain. And we went to Madrid, did another undercover operation, and ended up recovering $60 million worth of paintings, about 14 paintings that were stolen all at the same time from a private individual that lived in Madrid. We had developed the information here in the United States, and we were able to use that to go and create the undercover operation, Operation Cuba is what it was called, in Madrid and recover that. These paintings were stolen from a gallery in Minneapolis, Minnesota in 1979. They were taken at that time. There were seven of them all told. These three we recovered in Rio de Janeiro, Teresopolis, actually, Brazil. And they were recovered in 2001. So you can see those paintings were missing for, 22 years? And they went from Minnesota to Brazil. So you have Brazil, you have Madrid, you have Stockholm and Copenhagen. So you can see artwork travels, all right? Artwork is not contraband. Contraband is material that is in and of itself illegal. Generally speaking, it's drugs, guns, and money, okay? Over $10,000 or more, you have to declare it when you leave or come into the country. And if you don't, it becomes contraband. Same thing with drugs. most, you know, illicit drugs and guns. Firearms, weapons, they're contraband. But artwork is not. Unless the customs officer or the person at the airport knows that this piece is stolen, he's not going to stop it. He's not going to realize that it's a stolen property. And most customs officers don't know. Simple fact. They just don't know. So artwork travels. Travels internationally. So I'm going to tell you about Operation Masterpiece. It started in 2006. I had been involved in the art theft of the Isabella Stewart Gardner heist back from 1988 all the way through. I came in 88. I was in Philadelphia. And, of course, when it happened in 1990, I was well aware of it. And throughout the next 15 years, we monitored, we helped out with leads, anything that could be done to help Boston. We worked with the Boston office. In 2006, I got a call. I was in Philadelphia. And the call came from the legal attaché in our embassy in Paris. And basically, the attaché said, you know, we have a situation. Now, I was the head of the National Art Crime Team. So I was the supervisor of that team and therefore was, you know, the one who would take the call. And she said, well, we have a situation where a Parisian police officer has come in and said that he has an informant in Miami. And this informant in Miami has a contact who says he has two paintings that were stolen from a museum in the early 1990s, maybe late 1980s, and that these two pieces were stolen from the museum and they're still missing. So I said, okay, well, what else do we have? She said, I don't know. So this was in 2006. It was around May. Well, it just so happened I was gonna be in Paris in June for another meeting. And I was able to set up the meeting with that Parisian police officer. He was with the Paris City Police. And we met at the Louvre, right here by the pyramid. So he said to me, I have this guy who's in Miami. He would be able to work with you. And he's unearthed an individual who says he has two paintings that were taken from a museum in the United States in the early 1990s, late 1980s. I said, do you know what they are? Any idea? And he said, well, this guy, supposedly this criminal, all right, in Miami is not an art guy. He has no idea what he's talking about. He said, but he said it's a Rembrandt and a Vermeer. So the point was, this individual didn't know what a Rembrandt or a Vermeer was, but he had heard those words. So he said, it's two paintings, a Rembrandt and a Vermeer. And, you know, there's only 34 recognized Vermeers in the world. And there's only one missing, and it's our concert from the Gardner heist. So, you know, throughout the years, I'd done a lot of investigations, catching people who had stolen, you know, artwork and whatnot. And at times, we didn't catch anybody. We just recovered the artwork. In that case with the Norman Rockwells, no one was arrested, but we got the artwork back. Yeah. So it happens many times that way. You don't arrest anyone. You get the artwork. My goal was always get the artwork back. That was more important than catching the criminal who might have stole it 20 years before, 10 years before, whatever the situation was. Because by the time that you get to it, that situation, that person's long gone. So in this situation, we said, okay, I got the information from them. I got the name of the people to contact in Miami. And I went down, I started working undercover in Miami in 2006, meeting with these individuals. Ultimately, I was able to convince the French criminal that I was a dealer and that I was looking to buy the Vermeer and the Rembrandt and that we would pay $30 million for it. So he said, okay. He says, yeah, I think we can make it happen. We'll work this out. In order to convince him, I had to show him that I was a criminal. So at one point, we set up a meeting. And my job was to meet with these Colombian drug dealers on a yacht in Miami Harbor. And I would take this individual with me, and he was going to be my bag man, my muscle, you know, so to speak. And what I was doing, I was selling five stolen paintings that were stolen from Toronto to this Colombian drug dealer for his birthday. And his girlfriend wanted to give these to him. So we had to take the paintings. He had to carry the paintings with me. We took them onto the yacht. Of course, it was all an undercover operation. It was an undercover yacht. And we were able to go onto the yacht and have a little bit of a party, you know, with all the girls on the yacht, who were, by the way, all FBI agents. And So you can see me, I'm sitting here, and I'm next to the agent there, and she's the girlfriend of the Colombian drug dealers, who are both FBI agents. And there's our guy that we're convincing that he's that we're real criminals. Well, we did this production. We put on this little movie for him, and ultimately he bought into it, pretty heavy. So as a result, he said, yes, we'll do this operation. We'll see if we can get these paintings back. So he started contacting the people in France that he said had the paintings. And we said, okay, well, you know, find out what you want to do, and we'll start having meetings, and we'll talk. So in order to do this, we had to contact the OCBC, which was the police unit in Paris that handled these operations. And this, of course, were the paintings, the Rembrandt storm over the Sea of Galilee and the concert. So we contacted the OCBC. We spoke with them, the colonel there, the colonel of the gendarmerie, and he said, we'd be happy to work with you. Well, this is in 2006. We had done all this setup throughout the fall, and by January we were cooking. We had meetings with the head of the National Police in Paris, with the head of the gendarmerie in Paris, and our legal attaché as well, and the embassy was briefed, so we were ready to move. The only problem was I couldn't do undercover operations in France because it's illegal for someone to come from outside the country. You have to use their undercover operatives. So in other words, they have a group, a squad that does undercover cases, and we had to use them, but I could introduce them as my helpers throughout the case. Well, around February of 2007, right, we're in the middle of this, and in negotiations, there's a robbery. What happened was there was a apartment in Paris that where Diana Picasso lived. That's the granddaughter of Pablo Picasso. And somebody had gone into her apartment and stole two paintings, Portrait of Maya and Jacqueline. Those two paintings were worth somewhere in the neighborhood of about $60 million, these two Picassos. And so it became very important for the OCBC to get these paintings back. So as we're doing these negotiations in Miami with this criminal, he says, you know, I have some friends in Paris that want to sell two Picassos. Are you interested in Picasso? Well, not really. But if that's what we have to do, right, to get through, to get to the Gardner paintings, we'll do it. So I contacted the OCBC, and we talked about that. And what we did was we set up a situation where we would meet with the criminals in the Louvre, at the Louvre, right there by the pyramid, and they would bring us the two Picasso paintings. And I would send my assistant. He had to be a French police officer. Remember, I couldn't go, because in France, you're not allowed to work undercover. You know, you can't even make a phone call to France undercover, because you'll be breaking French law. Literally, you can't even make a phone call. So as a result, I had to send an officer from France. He went, and they took care of it. They actually got the two paintings back in this meeting. It was a bit of a problem because when the guys got arrested, they contacted their friends in Miami, and at that point, they thought that I was a snitch. So they wanted to kill me. Happens. So anyway, we went down to Miami. I met with them at the Diplomat Hotel in a bar there. There was two guys, they were called Salt and Pepper. They were sitting across from me at a table, and they had told me how they killed people with knives. You know, they said, we would stick you with a knife, or we'd come up to your car, next to your car while you're driving on a motorcycle. We'd come in and we'd shoot you through the window. Well, I wasn't worried about the car, but I thought, you know, they probably had their knives. So I took two guns. And I figured, well, I'll have two guns in my pocket, they'll have two knives, and they'll bring a knife to a gunfight, right? That's what I figured. Luckily, we didn't have to do that. I convinced them that it wasn't me, that it was actually wiretaps in France, that the assistant had been wiretapped, and that he was the one who unfortunately gave them up, but he didn't mean to. So they kind of bought off on it. So we were lucky. We were able to keep the case going, even though we had recovered these Picassos. So it's good. Well, they recovered those Picassos in August. Remember, they were stolen, I think, in February or March of 2007. They were recovered then in August of 2007. August the 7th is when the French police, you know, under our direction, were able to get these paintings back. Well, these are the two paintings. Well, you're not going to believe this, but on August 10th, 10 people went into a museum in Nice and did an armed robbery. 3 days after they got the paintings back in Paris on the Picassos. And so they go in, and these 10 guys do this arm robbery. They steal two Bruegels, and a Monet and a Sicily. Okay, it's Nice, right? The Museum of Fine Arts in Nice. Maybe we can get around this. Well, the OCBC calls and said there's a big problem. I said, what's this? The Monet and the Sicily belong to the Musée d'Orsay. That's the French government museum. So they weren't owned by the Nice Museum. They were owned by the French government. And so we had to get those back. So my guy, my criminal in Paris, he says, are you interested in the Nice painting? So I said, oh God, okay. Yeah, I'm interested in the Nice paintings. They're worth about $23 million. I said, we'll give you $4 million, if you can supply them. So we had to fly to Madrid, then from Madrid to Barcelona to meet with the bad guys who stole the paintings at the armed robbery in Nice. We went back to Paris and then to Marseille. It was just terrible. The things you have to do for the government. I'm just, but you know what? Somebody has to do it. So I did it. So we met with the criminals. We had long conversations, negotiating how we're going to do this. I had the two drug dealers with me. Remember the drug dealer thing on the yacht? Yeah, well, I had them with me because they were going to be my handlers. They were going to be the ones who were going to ship the material from Marseille back to the United States, Miami, on their drug dealer boat, which is how they got the Colombian drugs up from Colombia into Miami. So that was the idea. So we met with them in Barcelona, had the discussions, and finally they said, okay, this is what we're gonna do. And in May of 2008, they supplied the paintings to the French police again in Marseille. They were caught, they had all four paintings with them in a car, and they had a machine gun and a Chechen hand grenade in the car. So they all went on trial in 2011. What they said, their defense was that Bob, the FBI agent, was paying them to steal the paintings. Happens. So I just denied it, and they got convicted. But you know what happened? When they were caught, the French police did a search warrant. Now remember, most of the police don't know who I am. I mean, the rank and file policemen weren't. I was working with the colonels. So the rank and file policemen, they do a search of the house, and they find my card. Yeah, my undercover card. And then they tell the bad guys that I was an FBI agent. So as a result, we lost the opportunity to get the Vermeer and the Rembrandt at that point, because now these guys knew. And here's the thing. The reason I really believed, and the FBI really believed at the time, that these paintings could be there was two things. The French police had wiretaps, and they heard these individuals calling each other back and forth, talking about the Vermeer being in an apartment on Vermeer Street, and the other painting being in the apartment on Rembrandt Boulevard. Now, they're talking back and forth about this. Now, why would you think they would be using those names, those words, if they didn't have them? It doesn't make sense. And remember, we're not dealing with people who aren't thieves. This is not speculation. This is $85 million worth of paintings these guys stole and that they were supplying to us. And in fact, they told us they had 30 more in a warehouse from all the different gangs in France who were delivering them for this big guy in Miami who's going to pay all this money. So all these stolen artworks were coming back. Now remember, in France, they do steal art in order to get out of jail free. It does happen, okay? They can negotiate that under their legal system. So all of that made sense. And then the final straw was that we were told by the French police that the two individuals who had the paintings, the two paintings we wanted, they were Corsican people, Corsican brothers. Believe it or not, like the movie, but they were real Corsican brothers. They were in jail, and they still are, for murder. They had control of the paintings. They just wanted to get the money for their families. All right, that's what they were. We were told that by the gendarmerie in the OCBC, their organized crime bureau. So it made sense because, as Steve told you, back in the 1940s, the French government requested from the Gardner Museum to have the two regimental flags of Napoleon returned. The Gardner has two flags. They are the first regiment of Napoleonic Guards. They were from Corsica. Why would you think somebody would steal the Corsican Eagle off of one of those flags? Think about it. It makes sense, doesn't it? Why would you do it? Because it's a message, you know? You've got our flags, you never returned them. It's cultural heritage. It comes back to that. And these individuals were from Corsica, and, you know, they had these paintings. Now, I'm not saying they stole them, but they obtained them somehow, and they were holding on to them. So I think the real clue here would be the Corsican Eagle, the finial that came off of that flag. If we could find that, it might be interesting because, again, Steve said that somebody back in Bobby Donati might have had it in 1990. You know, criminals are very, very creative. So you have a situation where there's a big heist, and it's in the newspapers, all over the front of the Boston Globe, and they describe all the things that are stolen. And one of the things is a finial off of the flag. So a guy like Bobby Donati gets an idea, you know, I could show up with a video of a flag and nobody even know what it was. And so I could make a few bucks, right? Saying that it's the one, you know? And that's what he's probably thinking. I mean, think about that. So if he had done the heist that quickly and was showing up that fast, why would he be showing off pieces, you know, within a few days after all the hoopla that occurred in that situation? And the same thing goes with, you know, all of these claims. Having been in these situations, having spoken to these criminals and knowing exactly what they're thinking, how they work these things, a lot of these theories kind of are really shaky to me. I think these paintings were out there. I think somebody has them. I don't think they're together. You know, you're going to hear today, or not today, but you've seen it in the news where the speculation that the paintings are all together in an attic somewhere a couple of blocks away from the museum. I don't think so. Hey, look, the seven Norman Rockwells ended up, two ended up in Philadelphia, three and five in Brazil. Okay, think about it. The Rembrandt ended up in Stockholm, from Stockholm, ended up in Copenhagen, Denmark. They travel. And after 35 years, they travel. Yeah, so all these pieces I've seen that were gone for many years, they're not in the same spot that where they started from. They're all over the place. And so we'll see. I hope we get them all back, all in one spot. I'm afraid, honestly, for the pieces that were cut out of the frames, because from my experience, the pieces that I've seen cut out of frames don't last. The structure is held by the stretcher. And once you remove that stretcher and you roll these things up, that's 300-year-old paint and canvas. It deteriorates very quickly. So I really hope that they are still there. But the Vermeer was taken on the stretcher. So I have a lot of hope for that. So anyway, that's our theft. That was my contribution as far as that was concerned. And
you travel the world.
Yes.
You're like Rene Russo with the Thomas Crown Affair. You know, and I'm sure you look just as good in a lace dress. Well, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you.
Robert Wittman. The book is priceless.
I'd like to thank Alan, Bob, and Steve for enlightening us so much on everything tonight. Thank you all for coming out tonight. We do have copies of books for you to purchase if you'd like to have Bob or Steve sign your book. We also have copies of The Art Thief by the Patron Services Desk if you'd like to check one out today. Thank you all for coming. Good night.